welcome everybody. As I said before, and for the camera's sake, for anybody who isn't able to make it, we're trying to record it and maybe hoping to put it on YouTube. So my name is Tricia Young, and I'm the coordinator of the graduate programs here at MSU, Minnesota State University of Mankato. And I would introduce the other people. Here, Sandra Eggenberger is a faculty member. She did my part of the presentation yesterday afternoon, so you won't be meeting her this morning. Marlis Sandvi is our outgoing FNP, Family Nurse Practitioner Coordinator. And then Rhonda Bender, kind of manning the slideshow in the back, is our incoming FNP Coordinator. And so we're going to go a little informal here, and you know, we've got all the information slides and everything, but if you have questions as we go along, feel free to interject your questions. Our very last slide is one dedicated just to questions also, so we will just keep going. What does the next one look like? This looks like a place, this is this building, right, with a different look to it, so I had to throw that one in there. And basically just kind of give an overview. We're going to talk for hour, 90 minutes-ish, depending on how many questions go on and how long with it we become. And then kind of giving you the information that hopefully you find helpful. Hello.
Hi.
Come on in. And if you want to just sign in and grab a packet over there, grab a seat, that'd be great. We are just getting started. And so the... and then after that, then we're going to go into the other room, and you have the opportunity to write a brief essay, which is kind of all about you, so don't worry too much about it's not like a test or anything like that. So it's an opportunity for us to get a writing sample that we know you wrote on site, and so that goes into the application packet that we're putting together here. So. That's kind of what today is going to be about. And so, overview of the different programs that we offer to start out. The BS to DNP program, 81 credits, takes 5 years. You are prepared as a family nurse practitioner. And then the courses basically are one monthly meeting, sometimes two, depending on, you know, if a class, if you have two classes and it turns out to be like a 9-hour day, that might be scheduled 2 days, like an afternoon one day and then the next day in the morning to split that up. You recognize that 9 hours isn't exactly the best educational experience. So, and then other than that, it's primarily online. When you get into the clinical courses, that also changes. You might have 2 or 3 days a week in a clinical setting, in addition to the online and that kind of one day a month classroom setting. So in the BS to DNP program, there's 1,100 clinical hours in that program. So that is one option here. And the next one is, hi, come on in, sign up, and grab a packet, grab a seat. So then the post-masters, post-nursing masters, DNP, is basically 30 credits minimum, and this is for people who already are an advanced practice nurse and are coming in certified either as, you know, one of the four advanced practice nurses as defined by the Minnesota Board of Nursing, which is a nurse practitioner, clinical nurse specialist, nurse midwife, and nurse anesthetist. So in order to participate in our post-nursing master's DNP program, you need to have that certification. 5 semesters minimum and 350 clinical hours is part of this program. For our DNP students, we have been blessed with a gift from Glenn Taylor of $7 million several years ago. And that has enabled the faculty to establish an institute for family and societal nursing, family and society nursing focus. And one aspect of that is to provide scholarships for the DNP students who focus their clinical project, their capstone project, on family and society or family or society. And so So you have an opportunity to apply for a Becky Taylor doctoral fellowship if that is a focus of your project. And that money provides support for education and your research in that clinical scholarly project. You can use the dollars to pay tuitions, fees, other project-related expenses, living expenses, and so on. So that's something that we offer for the DNP students. The MSN degree is the degree for students interested in obtaining a master's degree rather than a DNP degree. And again, you're prepared as a family nurse practitioner. This program is basically kind of the first 3 years of the DNP, the BS to DNP program. And so you can choose to kind of step out, as we say, with a master's degree after 3 years. It's 53 credits. Again, it's primarily online with the one generally face-to-face meeting, except for clinicals and, you know, those odd times. The one course that does meet weekly face-to-face is the health assessment course, which you can probably understand because that is hands-on physical assessment, health assessment, and so that meets more frequently than once a month. So that happens like in the second year. And then we have a post-nursing master's FNP certificate. This is for people who already may be certified as an advanced practice nurse, maybe as a clinical nurse specialist or a nurse midwife, and want to come back and obtain FNP certification. And so we do offer this. The number of credits that you take and how long it is somewhat dependent on your master's transcript and the types of courses and the preparation that you've already had. So the curricular plan of study is somewhat individualized then for people who are interested in FNP certificate. You don't get the master's degree, but you get a certificate that enables you to sit for the FNP certification exam. And then our MS degree, if you noted that the MSN, the Master of Science in Nursing, was for the FNP preparation for the advanced practice nurse, our MS degree, Master of Science with a major in nursing degree, is for people who are interested in becoming a nurse educator. So it's specialized for nursing education. This degree, 37 credits, 7 semesters, and again, it's a similar format, primarily online with one monthly face-to-face meeting. Those face-to-face meetings are here at 7700 France. And then the teaching practicum hours, there are 160 teaching practicum hours in our nurse educator program. So we also have a post-nursing master's nurse educator certificate for people who already have a master's degree in another area and want to get a certificate as a nurse educator. And so again, that is individualized according to, you know, your previous education and the courses that you might need, that we identify that you might need to take. So at this point, Marlis likes to interject a question. And for those of you who came in a little bit late, I'm Tricia Young and I'm the graduate program coordinator for the graduate programs here. Marla Sandy is our kind of our outgoing FNP clinical coordinator. And then just grab a packet right there and sign in if you would. And then Rhonda Bender is our incoming FNP coordinator. And so if you came in late, we're going to move through this and have the opportunity for you to write the essay. And then at noon, I will come back and start this over again. So if you want, if you're able to, and if you want to hang out until you get to the slide where you walked in, that's kind of the plan that we're looking at for today. And at this point, I was just going to say, Marlis likes to ask the question.
Well, so actually, I just also want to say, I'm really glad you're all here safely. So thank you for making the effort, because we know what our effort was, and we anticipate yours was probably twice what ours was, so I'm glad you're here. It's been interesting the last two sessions to see what people's area of interest is for you individually. So how many of you are at this point thinking that you're interested in a master's degree with a step out master's for the FNP? Oh. How many nurse educator masters? How many postmasters certificate? How many BSN to DNP? And I missed somebody. How many postmasters nurse educator?
Oh, postmasters.
And then postmasters DNP. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Interesting.
Thanks. Okay, so. Talk a little bit about, and then before I get into the detail, the requirements, the application is due February 15th, and so you need to have all your information into Kim Horton at that time. The interviews, we plan to do interviews probably the first week in March, and then make a decision for admission for fall the end of the month, the end of March. And so yesterday there was a question, how many people usually apply and how many do you admit? So I'll address that question that's probably floating in your mind also now. And last year we had about 80 applications, and we are anticipating a similar amount this year, and we will be admitting anywhere from 12 to 18 students. And so it is highly competitive, and so I guess my free advice is not to put all your eggs in one basket, you know. So I encourage you to look at other programs and apply elsewhere in addition to here, so that if you don't get invited for an interview or whatever. Last year we invited, I think, 30 people for an interview. We did have a wait list, and so we waitlisted like 6 people. People are ranked, and so you do get a letter, you know, for an interview, and you do get a letter if you're on the wait list. This past year, we went through that wait list, and the person who was 6th on the wait list got a call, you know, like the day before classes started almost, and she was able to just say, yes, I can do it. So you never know. And so that wait list is there because people do apply to different programs, and sometimes they don't select us, and so then that opens up a spot.
When you said 12 to 18, is that per tract, or is that like...
Yeah,
is
basically for the FNP track. The nurse educator is separate. The certificate, the postmaster's FNP certificate students, those are a little separate also. And so for our basic entry, the BS to DNP is basically the same track as the step out master's, and that's where, you know, kind of for that whole track, whatever, is the 12 to 18. We would love to admit more students. We, you know, you've heard of the nursing shortage. Well, the nursing faculty shortage is even in a greater crisis stage. And so it's a matter of resources, and we just simply don't have the resources to be able to admit more students at this point in time. Any other questions related to...
As far as deciding between the FNP and the DNP, do you have to know when you start, or is that something that you can decide when you get to that step-out point?
You can decide that when you get to the step-out point, and I'll have something else to say about that when we get a little bit further along, a little bit more info about that. But yes, you do not need to declare it now when you're applying. You may want to make that decision by this about halfway through. But you don't need to know now, I guess that's the question.
Yeah, how many are, is it the same 12 to 18 for the nurse educator?
Yeah.
Did that apply, did I get in for that?
Yeah, it would be, I think last year we admitted 8 because there are just a much smaller number of people interested in it. And so for the nurse educator, it's almost more a matter of, do we have enough students to form a cohort, you know, to make it feasible for us. If there are only three people interested, that doesn't pay a faculty salary, you know, to offer that program. So generally, it's a very different issue with the nurse educator. Hi, come on in, have a seat. So, admission requirements. Basically, I think there's a handout detailing them because they're in detail. And
you know, after was I can do because they're straight off the web.
Oh, okay. So we didn't do a handout. Okay,
exactly the same thing.
Sorry. So the admission basically is twofold. So we have a college of graduate studies and research, and so you apply to that college and you need to meet kind of the larger university graduate school requirements, and they look at your transcripts and all that kind of stuff, and then they forward your application, your information to us saying that yes, this person has met the graduate school requirements. You also need to apply separately to the School of Nursing, so we have a specific application that you fill out for the School of Nursing. So it's kind of a twofold application. Your baccalaureate degree needs to be from CCNE or NLMC, School of Nursing, and then your GPA for your undergraduate degree needs to be 3.0 or greater. If it's not, then you need to take the GRE. So that provides us some evidence of, your thinking ability, and so we want to see that evidence. If you hold a master's degree, so if your undergraduate degree, you didn't get a 3.0 GPA, but you got a master's degree in, something else or in nursing, some area, then you don't need to take the GRE. We'll just take a look at your master's kind of GPA and take a look at that. So the registered nurse licensure in Minnesota, and then one that we get a lot of questions about is the 2 years of practice with a baccalaureate degree. And philosophically, the faculty we really believe that more education changes your thinking, as we hope it does. You know, it should. We believe that is what education is all about. It changes your thinking. And so we feel it's important that you practice with kind of that changed thinking, if you will. So despite the fact that somebody may have practiced as a nurse with an associate degree for 10 years or more, we really believe that getting a baccalaureate degree might change your practice, and we'd like you to have the experience in that changed practice and that changed thinking. And so that's why we have this particular requirement. So if you have 18 months of practice with a baccalaureate degree right now, then you'll be at the two-year mark in August when classes start. So you're good on that. And then a professional reference from a current or recent supervisor is also required. And then a resume, including all this detailed information on your resume. Now, we do this so that we can kind of get a picture of who you are. And so if there's something that you have done that you feel gives us a better picture and it's not specifically listed on here, just add that to the resume. So do you want to sign in and then just grab a packet there? And welcome. Glad you made it safe. So the next... and then if you're an international student, do look for the TOEFL test. And again, that's something that the graduate college requires, and so they kind of handle that information. And then the goal statement essay, which we'll do today for the last hour or so today. And we consider that then as your writing sample as part of the application packet. And then, as I said before, we'll select approximately 30 people to interview in early March. So let's look at that, and the essential abilities are another handout here. And we include these because it's just this listing to get you thinking about, analyze your myself, do I have these essential judgment skills, neurological function, communication skills? Emotional coping skills are extremely important in graduate school because it gets stressful, trying to balance work, life, and school. And so the intellectual conceptual skills are also important and other essential behavioral attributes. So we print this out and give it to you so that the admission requirements are on the back side of this.
Sorry.
I'm turning this around to show you the essentials, and there's the admission requirements. So to take home and just to read through this and just reflect on it. This is what I'm going to need for graduate school. And, you know, is there any work that I can or could do in the meantime to hone some of these skills or abilities? So, that is that. This is just from a poster presentation at the NLN conference last year of the School of Nursing faculty. So, course progression plan, which is kind of this goldenrod sheet. Start with the side that has most detail on it. So this outlines the, hi, come on in, glad you made it. Sign in, grab a packet, and Rhonda, I know there's a different photo after this there, that this is one of our assessment days that I'm looking at. Oh, yeah, go right in, grab a seat. And there's a screen down there. It's easier to look at that one from that perspective if I'm in your way here. We are recording this for people who aren't able to make it today because of the snow, so I need to kind of stand right here, and I try not to move around that much. And also, at noon, I'm going to start over from the beginning, if you're able to stay, and you can then leave at the point that you left in. So, goldenrod sheet, the progression of the curriculum. So the whole thing outlines the BS to DNP courses. So this is the 5 years, and that master step out is after that third year, kind of if you follow through growing across, the master step out at 53 credits. The courses with their individual clinical hours, for instance, if you look at fall year three, see that the adult health clinical course requires 250 clinical hours. So if you think that a semester is 15 weeks, you know, you're looking at 10 hours a week for 15 weeks, but usually you don't necessarily go into clinical for all of those 15 weeks, so it's probably closer to, you know, 15 hours a week, you know, so two full days in clinical for that particular course. Some of the other courses have just 100 clinical hours. But and so now, then if you go and add up the, go through to the next, the 700 level courses, which are all the DNP courses, and that totals, total credit should be 81 there for the DNP. I guess that this is a version that didn't get adjusted. But the decision to go for the step-up master's versus the DNP, in spring year two and spring year three, you'll see that there's a $695 for one credit each of those two springs, an alternate plan paper. And if you are going straight through for the 5 years for the DNP, you do not have to take those two credits, because that's kind of a scholarly project, and you will get plenty of capstone project courses in the end, in the summer year four, and then the two semesters for year five. You get like 9 credits of a scholarly project, your capstone project. And so, so that's why you might want to know by spring of year two if you're going to go straight through or if you're going to step out. Now, there's no reason that you can't take those if you choose to still think about it, you know, just to be sure that you have those credits under your belt if you want to get a master's degree, so you can always have extra credits. But But I'm just pointing that out as that might be a decision point in time to know how people to do that. Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Come on in, sign up, grab a packet, take a seat. You're kind of jumping into the middle here, but we welcome that. And I'll say once again that you just have to go right across.
Just right across.
Yeah, okay. It's been done. And that I'm going to start from the top again at noon, you know, so you can then leave when you come across your slide, if you're able to stay. Otherwise, we are recording this, and Kim's hoping if she can put it on YouTube, if people want to take a look at that.
You know, the only thing I would add is that is the whole thing about full time in two classes. I don't know that that comes up anywhere else.
Okay. So generally, the curriculum is laid out. You can see two courses a semester. 6 credits is defined by the graduate college as full time. So that qualifies you for like financial aid kinds of things. The curriculum also is laid out very sequentially. We offer courses only once a year. Again, that's a resource issue. We just have the faculty to teach the courses once a year. And they are in order. So if something happens, you have a life crisis, and you can't complete a course, or you don't finish a course, or a baby comes along unexpectedly, and something happens, you can't finish, then you're stepping out for a year. You're taking like a year leave because that course won't be offered again until, you know, the same time next year. And all the courses are basically required for the next courses that come after them. So the content builds sequentially. So you can't like miss one course in fall and then expect to continue to take, you know, the 2 courses in spring and then the next 2 courses in summer, because that course in fall is a requirement for, you know, a course in spring and a couple courses in summer. So just be aware that it is sequential and courses are just offered once a year.
Do they have to reapply?
No. Once you're admitted to the program, if you need to take a leave, there's a process for requesting a leave of absence. And then you just come back in. One of the nice things about this kind of arrangement is that you're with a cohort of students then, the same students, the same 12 or 18 students, and you go through together as a group, which is helpful. You know, you build relationships and support systems and all that kind of stuff. So by taking a leave of absence, you will join another cohort.
How come on the application it asks if you plan to take 2 or 3 courses a semester then? Pretty much you're taking 2. You really don't have the option to take 3, correct?
Exactly. Can you make a note of that? Because we will just strike that question. Because, which I didn't realize it was on there. Thank you. That is from a previous application where you had that option to do that.
The only other thing that we've added in the past at this point is talking about the idea of certification.
Oh, okay. Hello. So, how many people have heard the recommendation that the DNP is the mandatory degree for certification as an advanced practice nurse by 2015? People have heard that. And so the background for that is the leaders in nursing practice and education just taking into consideration the basically 3 IOM, the Institute of Medicine, reports that have come out in the last 10 years or so, one on the future of nursing and, you know, the quality and safety reports and everything. So in those 3 reports, the recommendations have been for nurses to be more highly educated at every level. So associate degree education up into, you know, maybe the baccalaureate degree is the required minimum degree for nursing. And that movement has taken off, and we're going to see fewer associate degree, you know, standalone programs. They'll be more feeding into baccalaureate programs. I think I see evidence of that all over the country. And then at the master's level, moving up into the doctoral level, another interesting phenomenon is we now have entry-level master's into nursing degrees that I haven't seen before. Those kinds of programs are taking off also. And so that would be for somebody like my niece, who has a degree in exercise physiology, and she isn't really able to get a job in that field. And so she could be somebody interested in going into nursing, and her best path with that undergraduate degree in exercise physiology might be to go to a master's in nursing program, which is an entry-level master's. So she would be learning entry-level nursing things, but she's already got a lot of the thinking and the research and kind of those things already developed in her previous degree. So different kind of program. But again, in response to the IOM reports on and recommendations to increase nursing education at all levels. Nurses should be more highly educated at all levels. And then the other aspect of that report is, or those reports, is that nurses, advanced practice nurses, well, and faculty prepared nurses should be practicing to the full scope of their educational preparation. And so for advanced practice nurses, we see the movement toward that in Minnesota in trying to eliminate the collaborative practice requirement or agreement requirement. So right now, advanced practice nurses in Minnesota need to practice in collaboration with the physician. You need to have a signed agreement, collaborative practice. And so we're pushing that, wait a minute, advanced practice nurses are educated to practice independently, and perhaps this isn't necessary. And we're trying to get that through the legislature. So you might see petitions to sign that you support this. So I encourage you to sign them if one comes across your email. Did you want to add anything else?
Well, just what do we do if it actually becomes a requirement for certification?
Okay, so so that's kind of the background as to why schools now are ramping up their DNP educational preparation, and master's programs are really going away. They're being phased out. I was at a meeting yesterday afternoon, and one of the faculty members from Metropolitan State University, you know, they just totally phased out their master's. They only have a DNP program now. They prepare family nurse practitioner also. And we're one of the few programs that still has a step-up master's, which is why I think we get the huge interest in people applying for the program here. So if this, and so some of the, in 2011, there were 184 DNP programs across the country in 40 states, with 101 still in the planning stages. And so at this point in time, I'm guessing there are close to 300 DNP programs, or programs offering DNP degrees in nursing. That compares to 125 PhD programs, and that number has maintained, has stayed steady. The number of DNP programs has just totally escalated in the last, you know, 8 years or so. In the last 10 years, we've gone like basically from zero to 300 in a decade. And so that, I'm just giving you that information to as evidence kind of to demonstrate that we are moving toward this being a requirement. Will it be required and necessary by 2015? I don't think so at this point in time, and this is just me talking, okay? And for those people who walked in late, I'm Trisha Young, and I'm the coordinator for the graduate programs here. Marla Sandby is our outgoing FNP clinical coordinator, and Rhonda Benson is our incoming FNP clinical coordinator. And if I feel the need to do that again, I'm going to call on somebody who was here at the very beginning to see if they want to introduce all of us. So, but we're totally glad everybody made it here safe. So my prediction is maybe by 2020, and I see this happening as the credentialing body who writes that certification exam and who makes money off of people taking that exam. Once the applicants and the people sitting and writing that certification exam get to a critical mass where they won't lose money when people take it, then I think that's when that shift to mandatory DNP might happen. That's just my prediction, and it's a lot of it's economics, which so much of, it's a huge influencer in all decisions that we make, right?
Right.
So,
I think the only thing that, I don't know if you guys have gotten into thinking this yet, but if partway through your 3 years that happens, you all just need to be informed that we can't guarantee that you can sit as a master's prepared family nurse practitioner for the boards. We think this class, probably, but that is not up to us, so we just want to make sure that it's very clear to you that you're taking a little bit of a gamble. And that is why when this curriculum was put together 3 years ago, 4 years ago now, we made it so that it could be seamless. So that if the powers that be make that a requirement that you have a DNP before you can sit, you can move straight through that DNP program. So yes, you might be interested in just the master's, but if that no longer exists, we have things in place so that
and you just need to be prepared to go on for the 5 years.
Yes. So.
And the other comment I would make about that is just think about your contemporaries going for an advanced practice role, one of the four advanced practice nurse roles. We'll be educated with the DNP for the most part. The people who already are certified with a master's degree will be kind of grandfathered in. That phrase might be familiar to people, so that you don't, if you've already been certified, your recertification with a master's degree you'll be able to do that. But now people coming in to get, to become an advanced practice nurse, the majority will be educated with the DNP. And so for yourself, just think about, with your cohort, like nationally, your national cohort of advanced practice nurses, kind of most people, up and coming will be educated with the DNP. Do you want to be educated with the DNP? Do you want to be educated with a master's degree? So thinking about that, but there are advantages to both educational avenues. So you step out with that master's degree, get a couple years of practice, and you come back in and finish out those 700 level courses and that clinical capstone project, you've got burning ideas for what you want to do for that project. Or somebody who goes through with the 5 years may not have the familiarity and the experience and practice to, have a burning idea. But, then again, you may. But so different, just lots of things to think about. Yeah.
So you just mentioned taking a break for 2 years. Is that considered, the break you were talking about before, where you could step out for a year or two and you're still considered in the program and then come back? Or
that's an interesting question. And it's not, when I spoke before, I talked about a leave of absence. So you would be, this would be different. This would not, you would not write for a leave of absence if you graduated with a master's degree. And so there would need to be some kind of application process, that post-master's DNP with the 30 credits, that's what you would apply for. Because you're already coming in certified as a family nurse practitioner. So we need some way of, monitoring our resources and our ability to offer that to people. So thanks for that.
So I was a little confused. You said the classes are only done at certain times every year. So if you did go post-masters, or you did go on to the DNP and you already had, you don't exactly start till the second year, or what I'm saying?
So the post-masters, you would enter into that curriculum right here in this fourth year.
Yeah, so you wouldn't start in the fall with everybody. You'd wait until they caught up and then you'd start the DNP.
You would be in a different cohort. So if you start classes this fall, you would start up here and then just keep going through. And if you're going the 5-year BS to DMP, you would just keep going through. Or, like right now in the room, I don't know in this room, but yesterday, there were people who raised their hands when we said, who's interested in the postmaster's DNP? So somebody, a clinical nurse specialist, or somebody who's already prepared as a nurse practitioner in, you know, acute care or something, is interested in starting right here, which we have classes, these 700 level classes start this fall. And we've got students all throughout here already. We've got, you know, 3 cohorts in the works, and so the cohort that started, you know, in fall 3 years ago is all set to proceed in at this point in time. Does that help explain that?
And Tricia, can you just briefly go over the nurse educator progression?
Thank you. So that's on the flip side of this, and basically this is the MS, the Master of Science with a major in nursing degree. The courses progress over those 7 semesters. You'll see that there are some similar courses, and so the nurse educator students and the FNP students do take some courses together, some of the general courses, like the nursing theory course, the ethics course, family nursing science course. And so then you separate out kind of into the individual specialty areas. So focus for nursing education, those courses will be separate from the courses focused on family nurse practitioner. And the other thing that I'll say is that you might observe that we have in like spring of year 1, family nursing science. That is the result of this focus that the faculty have at Mankato because of our gift from Glenn Taylor on family and society. So our goal were to be experts in family and societal nursing care. And so we have developed curricula to kind of reflect that. Our undergraduate curricula right now that just started this past summer prepares undergraduate, you know, generalist nurses to focus on the family as the unit of care rather than the individual as the unit of care. And because we really believe that that kind of focus by nurses might revolutionize healthcare and healthcare outcomes. So we'll see how that works. So that family nursing science doesn't mean just family nurse practitioner or whatever, it's just more general. It's what is family nursing science and theory and nursing actions regarding family. Anybody have any questions about the curriculum?
I was asking, suppose you start out with the master's and then midway through you change your mind and you have to go to the end.
Yeah, you can. You do not need to identify at the outset if you're going to go for the master's or the DMP. You don't really need to know that at the beginning right now. You can decide partway through the program. And so that application process, we would need to know in that third year of, you know, like at this time, is when we're looking to count the numbers for fall classes. So in your third year in that master's degree would be when we would need to know if you're going to go through, because we would need to have a space for that. So.
Yeah, if you decide to go on for the DNP, can you take those 2 credits, graduate with the master's and keep going and sit for the boards at that master's?
Yes.
And then
yes, you can.
Mm-hmm. And you sit for the board twice, suppose you're done at master's level and the DM on the board you sit for, or the master's level just
The certification exam is right now the requirement to sit for that certification exam is a master's degree. So it's the same exam right now. So you would not have another exam. The DNP is a Doctor of Nursing Practice degree. So that would be the degree that you would get, which would be different from the certification. The certification you get from the exam. So you wouldn't, you wouldn't retake that exam because you would already be certified with the master's degree. Yeah.
Can you speak to the credentialing bodies a little bit? From what I've heard and can see online, the American Academy of Nurse Practice is going to say about their FNP certification. So from what I can see, there will only be one credentialing body that's going to keep their FNP certification, and that was the American Nurses Credentialing Center. Is that
I do not know that. That's very interesting. Are you sure you're not thinking about the adult nurse practitioner program certification going away? Because now it's going to be adult Gerald?
No, this what I was reading was talking about FNP, just because, I've heard from other nurse practitioners a big push to eliminate FNP altogether.
What?
And
I can't speak to it, but I was not aware of any push to eliminate.
I'm not saying it's going to happen, but that they're trying to do adult zero acute, adult zero primary, pediatric acute, pediatric primary. And so when I tried to look up this information online, the only article I found was one talking about the different credentialing bodies, and the one concrete thing it said was that the American Academy of Nurse Practice is going to eliminate their FNP test in 2015. But American Nurses Credentialing Center still said that they were going to have their FNP test.
So I get emails from them, and I don't know that. And so I just apologize that
as a
current,
are those the two credentialing bodies you told
those
your
are the
students
two
to sit?
Bodies.
Okay.
And generally, I would say 80%, maybe 90% of our students sit for the AANP one.
Okay.
The folks who are interested in the ANCC one are the ones who hope to practice in Canada because they only accept that one. I guess maybe that's the one difference that I know. There are differences in the components of the exams, and I just went to a national review on those last year at this time, and wow, none of that was discussed. So I have some research that I need to do to try and see what you're referring to. I'm sorry, I don't know it.
And like I said, I could not find any real concrete information when I tried.
My understanding is that actually there's a larger push towards FNP, just because if you are a physician, you're not a pediatric physician, you're a physician, and then you specialize. And so that's been the draw of the FNP for so long, is that yes, we need specialists, go for specialties once you kind of have that baseline. So I just, that's the paradigm I've been working off of, and again, I just apologize that I've not even heard those rumors. So it could be true, and I certainly will find out.
And I would have to add, it would be incredibly poor timing in our nation's progression of events to eliminate the family nurse practitioner with the Affordable Care Act coming into full focus here in the next year or two. Primary care is where nurses will thrive in practice and really be able to fill some of the gap left with the shortage of family practice physicians. So it would just be really poor timing to even engage in that discussion, I think. But interesting that you've heard those comments.
Yeah, thanks. I'll look into
it. Okay, so some of the expectations that we like to spell out initially, so you can be thinking about this and what it takes to get through graduate school. the general overall university thought is that you might have 3 hours of homework to expect for every one credit. So every one credit, in most of the courses are 3-credit courses, so you got an hour of time in class per week for that one credit plus 3 hours of homework, so that's like 4 hours per credit total. So if you have 6 credits in a semester, 6 times 4 is going to be 24 hours a week, which is why, and that 18 hours a week there is for homework. So 24 hours a week all told. And that's basically to get by in the courses, you know, to pass the courses. To excel in the courses, you can expect to put in more than that. So we highly recommend that you don't work any more than half time while you're in graduate school. And so remember I said that 6 credits is counted by the graduate college as full time? Well, full time is, you know, that's what that means. And so we just really discourage people from working full time. People will think they can do it and try to do it, but if you want to have any kind of a life, you know, we just, for 3 years, you know, for that long of time, and get out sane and happy and all that to survive, we just really recommend no more than half time.
Can I add a tap dance to that? So we say this every cohort that's coming in, that you can't, sorry, we say this every cohort coming in, that you can't possibly survive and succeed. And many people, because of their family situation, benefits, all that sort of stuff, have to work, have to maintain, let's say 75% or whatever. I'm here to tell you that really bright students have not successfully passed classes because they are working full time. I have no doubt, because the second time through they make it work financially or whatever, and they do great. But we have had students have to step back a year because they were trying to do the full time thing. They were trying to go to school, you know, 30 hours a week. Oh, by the way, I have a family. Oh, by the way, whatever. And so a piece of this information session is to make sure that you all understand what you're getting into, what the requirements are going to be, what you have to do just to maintain sanity and be successful. And this is huge. I will tell you that a formula that seems to work fairly well is for those of you who are in perhaps the hospital setting who have the option of the 12-hour weekends. I think most places that allows you to maintain a 75%, which then allows to maintain the benefits. And that has been very successful for students for a long time. But again, we cannot require that you don't work full time, but we would so strongly, and I will save you the tap dance, I won't do that. We would so strongly encourage you to anticipate that you will hugely need to cut down your hours. So sorry for the station identification, but I just hate to see people stumble when they are more than capable of being very successful. So
one little story that I like to share, when I was commuting to Madison, Wisconsin to get my doctorate, and I boarded with a woman down there who was also in school, and anyway, she lived there, but I just commuted every week, and I would stay down there overnight, you know, one or two nights a week, depending on when my classes were, because that was at a time when classes were all face-to-face. We just didn't have online education then. And so one night, I'm going to bed, and I'm like, okay, what time should I set my alarm for in the morning? And I'm like, oh, well, if I don't wash my hair, you know, and if I don't wear any makeup, then, you know, I can set it for this time. So then I lay there thinking, you know what, if I go to, like, washing my hair every other day, and I never wear makeup, and I added that up to, I'd have 2 hours a week, you know, and that was, like, a gift. So I'm just telling you that that's what graduate education is like. You are reduced to or thinking this way. So, okay, move on to the next slide. The clinical courses, you know, will require 2 to 3 days a week, and so again, you can factor that in. And then just a little note about preceptors, what you can expect. We highly encourage you to identify someone, to create a relationship with someone that you is willing to precept you in the different clinical courses. And if you, that makes things go a lot easier, but if you can't find anybody, then we do work with you to find a preceptor. Preceptors can be close to home, and so, you know, they don't need to be in the metro area or in the Mankato area or whatever, they can be close to your home, which is where you have those relationships. relationships established with healthcare providers in your community. So that's why it's sometimes more helpful to kind of work with somebody. Now, hi, come on in. Glad you made it safe. And welcome. So, questions?
As,
yeah.
As far as finding a preceptor to work with, they need to be an FNP preceptor?
So preceptors. So maybe a little bit of a tap dance on this. So I'm the clinical coordinator, and theoretically I help find sites, but the reality of it is that each of you with your personal relationships are what really make the sites happen. I all the time call clinics, the manager, you know, do all the stuff you're supposed to do to make a great relationship. And they'll say, no, I'm sorry, we don't have any students who are already precepting, whatever. But if you talk to a pediatrician person down the street who you know from church or something and say, I'm desperate, I need something, they'll be, oh, sure, come on in. Have, you know, your school call my manager. So I'm calling the same person back saying, okay, so now such and so is going to be with this person, and what do I need to do to make that happen? So you guys are the key to your own successes. We will do our darndest to support it. We need to make sure the paperwork's in place, that the contracts are in place between that organization and Mankato. But we have limited success in, you know, making blind phone calls and getting a lot of leads. So just know that piece. So then who can the preceptors be? If you, and I'm sorry to those folks who are here for nurse educators, we're going to be talking about nurse educators again in a little bit, so if you look at your goldenrod sheet here, the first semester is two theory sorts of classes. Beginning that second semester, which is the spring of your first year, you have one kind of clinical-based course, that pathophys, and then one more theory course. And then the rest of the way through the program is pretty much one clinically oriented course and then one not as clinically oriented, or perhaps the didactic of adult health disease processes, that sort of thing. It is not until summer of the second year when you will be doing your first clinicals. In the women's health clinical, you can be with a family practice person who does tons and tons of OB and women's stuff. More ideally, you're with a women's health nurse practitioner or a certified nurse midwife or an OBGYN. So that semester, it's that combination. Fall of your third year is your adult health rotation. That can either be an FNP, an adult nurse practitioner, an internal medicine physician, or a family practice physician. Because again, and then if you're with family practice during an adult health, you absolutely can't see anyone under 18. So, but you're not seeing older patients with them anyway, so that's fine. In the spring of your third year, you're in pediatrics. We highly, highly, highly recommend that at least half of your clinical hours are either with a PNP or a pediatrician. This is the hardest semester to place students with because many PNPs and pediatric offices are very focused on medical students and PNPs. And so there are some systems where they don't even consider placing a student of ours, including Children's Hospital, where some of our FNP students are employees. They will not let these great employees and great students be there because they just have this policy about PNPs only. So we say half of your clinical hours as a bare minimum, because the reality may be that you're splitting a pediatric site with someone else and flip-flopping between a family practice site and a pediatric. And then the only time that it has to be an FNP or a family practice physician is that third semester when it's the family practice curriculum, because we really want you to experience wholeheartedly that womb-to-tomb patient care load where you'll be kind of reviewing all the stuff that you've been learning forever. So does that answer your question? Yes. So there is quite a variety of preceptor specialty, or lack of specialty, I guess, generalist, that we allow. Also, in that final semester, for those of you who have a burning desire to work in nephrology or something, we allow up to 50 specialty clinical hours. What it absolutely doesn't cover, and I think there's a slide a little bit later about it, but I'm on a roll, so what it doesn't cover is any any inpatient or ER, any inpatient or ER placements. I bet all of you know of family nurse practitioners who make great hospitalists, maybe in the organization where you work or whatever. And who is better suited to be a hospitalist than a nurse who has worked there before, and now they're coming back with new skills and in a different role, and it kind of philosophically makes sense. But the problem is there is nothing about our program that prepares you for anything but primary care. We do not do any acute care education. And so people who have an FNP who apply for and get and become great nurse practitioners in the ER, in the hospital, are out on a legal limb, because as soon as that patient who was going to go south anyway goes south, it's your watch, and that something bad happens, the lawyers are hungry, and they're going to say to you in court, so what was it about your educational preparation that prepared you for this role that you took on? And the answer is absolutely nothing. So if that is a role that you guys are interested in, I highly encourage you to look into an acute care nurse practitioner program, because you'll get the clinical, the didactic, theoretical background for those acute care roles. So when we talk about that specialty rotation that you're able to kind of come up with for yourself, if you're interested in urgent care, that's still primary care. So that would be something that you could consider. Questions on any of that?
So in that case, that seems to be where you're leaning towards, but then you go ahead with application anyway. Are you able to detect that from reviewing someone's application? Are you automatically going to drop them out and say, well, they seem to be leaning towards acute, let's consider somebody else? Because,
you know, we haven't come across that issue in the past. I just hope people hear loud and clear what I'm saying. You know, if that's something you're considering, we encourage that everybody applies for at least one other place just because of the crazy numbers game. But B, we wouldn't keep you out of the program, but I feel like I would be wasting your money if that's what you want to be doing, because it's not the right program for you.
Because I'm saying that because that might be your interest, but
right.
Also you might be willing to consider other places.
Right. And that needs to lie within your own knowledge. Other questions?
Yes. So at the clinical sites, how many of the professors visit those sites and how often?
It depends. So one of the things that it depends on is how well we know the preceptor. And we know that they get, you know, where the student's supposed to be at any given time. But generally, you get a site visit one or two times a semester, kind of depending how many hours are in that given semester, how it's going. Honestly, the first time I visit a given preceptor, I'm evaluating the preceptor just as much as I'm evaluating the student, just to make sure that they get it, they understand the nurturing role, the importance of setting a little time aside, that they're setting expectations, they're reviewing your work, they're supporting you, all that kind of stuff. So there's different reasons why we make more than one or two site visits, but generally it's one or two
and
site visits.
Do you also?
Thank the Lord, no. Not all of them. it depends how many students are in a class. Each faculty in a clinical course has 6 students, and so I would do half the class or a third of the class, and so we split it up. And then whoever's doing your site visits is who does, like, your journal reviews and your log reviews and all that kind of stuff. So there's continuity there. Yes?
Can you use the same preceptor for multiple clinical rotations?
You can, but we would not recommend that. Every once in a while, we've had folks from the boonies, and there's not a lot of options, and they really want to work in that clinic in the boonies, and so that might happen. But let me take that question and morph it a little bit. The other question is, can you work within that same health system the whole time? And the answer again is yes, you can, but we don't completely recommend it. And the rationale is, every place you work and every preceptor you work with, you will learn something from. And so if you grew up in that health system, you would, you're working there now, and now you're still doing this, your paradigm is much more narrow than the person who kind of shifts around a bit. I will tell you that generally the systems are very supportive of their own employees. They feel like we've already invested a lot in you, and we're willing to, you know. And so generally, people have a better time, an easier time, getting placed within the system in which they're employed. If that is the case with you, I would encourage that at least one of your semesters you are outside of that. It's a pain to have to learn new EMRs. You know, that's the worst part of the whole thing. But you know what? You thought this one was good, and all of a sudden now you're working with this one. Like, oh, I'm going to be a nurse leader. I need to bring some of these ideas back. So long answer to a short question. Sorry. Other questions? Yes.
Does it have to be an NP or physician, or can it be a PA?
Your primary preceptors need to be either a physician or a nurse practitioner. But I'm here to tell you, as not a student, you can learn from absolutely everybody, and there's some great PAs out there. And so we certainly accept PA preceptors as a piece of that collaborative team. And even if you only have a, let's say you have a nurse practitioner preceptor, well, guess what? She's going to a conference, he's going to a conference, and it's not that you have to cancel that clinical day, it's make sure you've established relationships with the other folks in the clinic. It's invaluable to work with other people. That first semester or so, we encourage, you know, much more monotherapy, shall we say, just because you don't want all these other ideas confusing you. But once you kind of get the lay of the land, it's great to see how different people practice and take whatever you can from each one of them. Other questions? So this is great, because I think some of these coming slides address some of this, and we can just go right past it. So what are the academic performance expectations for your time in graduate school? I think the most important one is the very first one. So strong graduate level communication skills. That's not just being articulate in your speech, it's making sure that you can communicate very efficiently, directly, concisely, in writing as well. There is not a single grad student in any program across academic institution that doesn't complain about the papers they have to write and everything else. Well, welcome to the club. You guys will be having papers, and we hear from our students, I'm going to be writing in charts. I'm not going to be writing 10-page papers. Why do I have to do this? Well, it's looking at that whole picture and organizing your thoughts and learning how to review the evidence and the data and experience of other people and putting it concisely into a paper, because then we're going to be narrowing that down to things like charts. And EMRs are everybody's nightmares, and the thing I dread the most about going out on those site visits is looking at the garbage that's in EMRs. And so we are expecting our grads to go out there and set different expectations and do things differently so that they can still be efficient, but it'll be meaningful documentation and communication rather than blather, because there's a lot of blather out there. So anyway, strong communication skills. Academically competitive, so here's the whole truth that Tricia has already addressed, which is we'll have around 90 applicants for around 12, possibly 18 if we can scare up another faculty person in the cohort. I would bet, based on other years of applicants, that every one of you is fully qualified to take one of those 12 spots. And so the two things about that are, number one, if you get one of those 12 spots and you come to class, you will be judged against those other super performers. And as a super performer who's never gotten anything but an A in her whole life, you probably will break that trend. So just know that it is very academically competitive. The second thing, I was going somewhere else with this. The other thing is, if you are not invited to an interview or invited to be a part of the cohort, please don't think it's because you weren't good enough, because that has not been our experience, and we really want to encourage you to continue to follow your dreams as they evolve and reapply here. Make sure you're applying to other programs. It's just crazy faculty shortage, so please know that we get how qualified the huge majority of our applicants are. So, yes?
If we are not selected for an interview or for a spot, can we send an email or correspondence to you and have some advice of what we could do in the future? future to make ourselves more, you know, whether you say it's, you know, the GPA or it was your writing sample or, you know, something, is there any kind of help that we could get that way for future kinds of applying?
Just email me.
Okay.
So you'll be emailing me for the essay.
Okay.
So you'll have my email address. And it's online. Patricia Young.
I just want to make sure I haven't missed anything because we have talked about a lot of this. So critical thinking skills are absolutely mandatory. You've got to wade through what the patient thinks was really important to figure out what really is important. You need to wade through lots of emails from every institution that says, oh, this research finding is really valuable and you need to put it in your practice. You need to be able to sift things out and come up with appropriate ideas of what you're assessing, whether it be social sorts of things, whether it be the physical sorts of things, whether it be the environmental sorts of things, into how do I, because remember, efficiency is everything in today's medicine, so how do I focus on the important systems that I need to be physically assessing to now, what do I really think this is? What is my diagnosis? Is that it or is it not? And then in that plan, what can I say can wait and what can't I, whatever. So all the things that you'll do through grad school eventually culminate at those skills that you'll be getting through theory courses and everything else. So, next one. It just cracks me up that I get the computer required because there is not a less technical person in this room than I am. So if you guys can refer to this yellow handout, this comes right off the IT website at Mankato State. And we just wanted to make sure that there was a spot in the program where we talked to you about the importance of making sure you have up-to-date technical hardware and software at your home so that an online program is feasible. In order to survive in this course, you need to be computer literate. You need to be able to problem solve because problems will happen, and they will happen when IT is closed on the weekend when faculty aren't available. And so oftentimes it is because your Java isn't updated or because whatever. So please make sure that you go home, you figure out what you have at home, and you figure out how to update it. Most of it is free update sorts of stuff. New mechanics wouldn't be, but the software stuff is free as far as I can think. As far as basic stuff like Microsoft Office, new computers and such, if you go to the website, the IT website, there are links and programs where you get a Mankato discount for that sort of stuff. So this is very premature to be talking about this at an info session, but just to make you aware of those resources and the requirements. So short and sweet. And so the family nurse practitioner role, on to the next one. We've been surprised in the past when folks have gotten here and not had a big idea of what the role consists of, and through questions I think we've already addressed some of this stuff, but again, just a brief review on this. And I always start this talk off by what the family nurse practitioner is not. And so this is my little political soapbox. We are not physician extenders. I don't think that's a surprise to any of you in here. But it's important that we continue to get that word out. We see many of the same patients. We end up with many of the same outcomes, but we do things differently. And so to be thought of as a physician extender makes me crazy. So keep that in mind and have that conversation with your colleagues. The other thing that I don't think we are, which how many of your systems call NPs and PAs mid-level providers? Anybody? I think it's the most common way to lump NPs and PAs together. In the Twin Cities, there's a real push to call us advanced practice providers. That's what we are. And it does not imply that stratification that mid-level providers implies. You know, mid-level says there's someone who's top level, there's someone who's bottom level, and we're somewhere right around the belly button, you know. That's not true. All the research shows that patient satisfaction, patient care outcomes, we equal the other providers in the mix. And we highly value the participation and the expertise and the things that we learn from all the other providers, but we're an important piece of those providers. providers. So that's what we're not. Our scope of practice is determined by the Nurse Practice Act. You will always sign your name, Susie Q, RN, either MSN or DNP, FNP. So RN is always a piece of it. You do not get a nurse practitioner license. You get your RN license, you maintain your RN license, and you have your nurse practitioner certificates, which show that you successfully passed the exam. So from there, I take you into, okay, so what is a family nurse practitioner? And what we at this college really emphasize is that each of those words in the title is as important as the other. Family nurse practitioner. So family, we've already talked about our emphasis on family care. And how we like to see our patients through the lens of the family. And I think most, that's not just unique to Mankato, that's all programs. So family, nurse. So it makes me crazy when someone says, oh, I'm just a nurse. There's no such thing as Jan, just a nurse. you are a nurse. You bring to this role, to this educational process, all your expertise, your patient interaction skills, your critical thinking from the experiences you've had as a nurse. You bring insights about families, you bring insights about where people are coming from in their various stages of life. It is the nurse in you that you will carry through the rest of your career that will set you apart. So embrace it, rely on it, your nursing judgment, the gut feeling, the intuition that you develop as a nurse will pay off dividends in your practitioner role. So then the third one, the practitioner role. So what are some of the things that you guys think, this is just to make sure that you're awake, what are some of the things that you guys think are encompassed in the practitioner role for FNP? What are some of the things that you're going to do? Who sees the FNP as your provider? So you guys know. So what does an FNP do?
Examine, diagnose,
diagnose, treat, assess. Not only to your patients, but to your colleagues and to the system. I mean, our system is, it's shifting sands under our feet right now, and it's a lot of keeping that ear to the ground, whether that's in your patient's life or in your clinic or across the healthcare spectrum. So, definitely.
Coaching and educating, I would add. Coaching and educating, I would add to that list.
Huge. And I think that's one of the things that we do differently. I'm always surprised when I have students that I go to visit in a site visit, and yep, they tell them the nuts and bolts of what they need for their whatever. It's like, no, send that little piece of paper so that they remember what you said. So that's huge as far as getting the patient on board. And you know what, to take that a step farther then, it's collaborative practice. And that's with the patient. Making sure that the patient is tuned in to what your recommendation is and has signed up, basically. You know, make sure that you're both on the same page and they're an active participant. And guess what? They say, oh no, my mom doesn't work well on that antihypertensive. I'd like to just try diet. Okay. Then we're going to start with diet and reevaluate, and then we'll come back and together we'll figure out something else. So making sure that with that education is a discussion so that you have a common plan and are supporting their role in their diagnosis. This list of components to advanced practice comes from a text that we use in the program throughout the program by Hamrick and a bunch of other folks who have identified these particular components, which I don't need to read it off. I think it's pretty clear. But it shows how much variety there is. In addition to the common sense stuff of looking at someone's nursing practitioner role and saying what they do, our curriculum is also guided by the National Organization for Nurse Practitioner Faculty, who have come up with a list of competencies against which programs are judged to make sure that we're providing this education. And again, I will not be reading this off, but I do want you to note that as you look at these additional things, which our students are evaluated on throughout their clinical courses, and these things have guided our curriculum. So whether it's the nurse educator track or the nurse practitioner track, you'll see that we're making sure that we are preparing the things that the NOMP faculty believe are most important in the nurse practitioner program. So, and then we already have kind of addressed this. Primary care is what we're preparing you for. So that would be the internist office, the pediatric office, the family practice office. Retail care, which some people enjoy, urgent care, are all primary care. Specialty clinics. So again, we do that 50 hours of specialty if you're interested, that final semester. If, as an FNP, you opt to work within a specialty clinic, that will all be OJT sorts of specialty information. We truly are at that primary care. This is when I usually tap dance about that you can't do the ER and hospitalist role. Educational roles are huge for NPs. If anybody is interested in being a nurse practitioner, getting some experience, and coming back to be a faculty member after they've gotten their DNP, as you know after today, we welcome that. But it's not just academic institutions where you're in an educational role. Each NP in their clinic is in an educational role with an opportunity to make sure that everybody from the MAs to the office clerks to the other providers within the clinic are up to date on, you know, what the latest evidence is, what the latest trends are, the things that have worked in other places and haven't worked. So think of yourselves, and you do, you're nurses, so you guys already think of yourself as educators. That will continue. Managerial roles, I think part of our mess with the, this is the world according to Marlis, but I think part of the mess with our medical system is that as providers, as nurses, we relinquished control over our paradigm. And we need more providers back in managerial roles so that as a provider you can help impact what the system is going to be. And research, everything is evidence-based practice these days. And so part of our emphasis on research in the program is to make research and participation in research a piece of your approach to healthcare. That's our assessment class.
I would just talk a little bit about the nurse educator role. The curricula is also guided by the nurse educator competencies established by the National League for Nursing. And so this tells us that people who are prepared, educated to specialize in nursing education ought to be able to facilitate learner development and socialization, to use assessment and evaluation strategies, to write curriculum and evaluate it, to be a change agent and a leader, to pursue quality improvement, to engage in scholarship, and to function within the educational environment. And so our nurse educator MS program is, you know, kind of, we make sure that you can do all these things when you graduate after going through that curricula. And then some of the opportunities, the graduates are prepared to sit for the certification exam as a nurse educator, the CNE exam, that is also written by the National League for Nursing. Now this credential or this certification is not required or mandatory to practice as a nurse educator, unlike an FNP certification or certification as an advanced practice nurse. So this is something that is optional. It is your choice, but you would be prepared to sit for that certification exam if your employer is looking for certification, or many people who can put that CNE after their name, maybe that changes your salary as a faculty member, something, you get a boost or something like that. So I just wanted to say that. And then academic settings, I'm going to go back for 2 seconds. Graduation was a little premature there, but anyway, and then clinical settings, you're prepared, and the only thing that I want to say about that is to teach in an academic setting with a master's degree, you will be able to teach in an associate degree program, and to, you know, kind of like get permanent employment in an associate degree program or whatever. If your aspiration is to teach at MSU or to teach at the university, a four-year program, basically, you're going to need a doctorate. And so with a master's degree, this will educate you to have that knowledge to teach, you know, to have that focus on nursing education, that specialty area. But in order to get tenure at this university anyway, and at many four-year institutions, and then to be eligible for promotion through assistant professor, associate professor, and full professor ranks, those are promotion, and then to get tenure, you will need a doctorate. And so if you, and then what kind of doctorate becomes another question. So, you know, a DNP is considered a terminal degree. That's the name for the doctoral degree in university institutions, is do you have a terminal degree or not? Which, yeah, it's kind of strange, but that's, I'm just saying what everybody says. So a DNP is considered a terminal degree. A PhD, an EDD, and so, but some institutions will only look at a PhD or a PhD in nursing. So if that is your goal, I'm happy to talk to you individually. Give me a phone call or send me an email, and I can explain all that. And one other little thing that I want to say about our DNP program, I said philosophically, the DNP, when the American Association of Colleges of Nursing, the AACN, put out their essentials for DNP education, and they looked at the IOM reports and everything, as I mentioned those earlier, and they put out what are the essential competencies for DNP education that guides our curriculum, and the original intention of the AACN for the DNP is a Doctor of Nursing Practice, and so that advanced practice nurse, those four roles of nurse practitioner, clinical nurse specialist, nurse midwife, nurse anesthetist, that was the original intention, was that the DNP would serve those four advanced practice areas. Now, many schools in that proliferation of DNP programs that I mentioned, have created DNP programs for nurse educators, for nurse administrators, for nurse leaders. However, philosophically, the faculty at MSU, we followed the AACN original recommendation, and that was for the four specialty areas. So if you are thinking that you want to be a nurse educator, and get a DNP with us, you won't be able to do that because one of the requirements for our DNP is certification in one of those four areas. So philosophically, we're just following what the AACN originally recommended in 2006, I think it was, when they came out with their proposal and their recommendations for DNP education. So I just wanted to, forgot to make that point earlier. So now we can go through graduation, some of our graduate students from past years, and then on to any other questions. And I would also give the overview for, I know there were a lot of people who came in at various times and came in late because of the weather this morning. And so that's fine. We're glad everybody made it here safe. And so what we're kind of going to do now is to go into the other room to shift so that you can write the essay. As I might have said, the essay is all about you, so you didn't miss anything that we might have covered. And then after the essay at noon, if you are able to stay, I'm going to start from the top and go through the PowerPoint again. And then you can leave when you come to the slide where you walked in. So that's kind of what we're doing. Kim Fortin also is recording this, we hope, and hopes to put it on YouTube, and we'll send out a link if that works. Sometimes that technology stuff isn't always, well, sometimes it works great and other times it doesn't. So anyway, so I'm going to go through starting at noon again, and that'll be back in here. I mentioned before, for those people who took 2.5 hours to get here and you're anticipating, there's a cafeteria right below us on the second floor, so feel free to go in and feed yourself before you hit the road on the way. Way back, it's fairly inexpensive, so just point that out. Before we break to go for the essay, I'll also point out where the bathrooms are if you want to quickly stop into the restroom. And that would be out the double glass doors that you came in through. And you can, there's two options. You can either take a left there, and then they're kind of right at the end of the hallway to the right a little bit, or if you keep going straight, like all the way straight, 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 there is another set of restrooms on the right-hand side. So, and then just come back, and right across the hall here is a room with a bunch of computers, and I will be standing at the door there. I'll give everybody the essay question. Please note that there's two kind of forms of the question for two different groups of students. So if this is the first time that you're applying to MSU and you're looking for the master's program or the BS to DMP program, you don't have a master's degree already, then just, if this is your first application, you're not an advanced practice nurse, then look at these. If, however, if you've applied to MSU before, or if you already are an advanced practice nurse, then look at this bottom questions. There's just a slight variation. And then there's information on how to send it to me via email when you're done. And we're also going to save it to a jump drive in case the email thing doesn't work. So there will be some of us in there at the end to save it to a jump drive for you. So now that I've kind of explained all that, those of you who walked in late will have the opportunity to kind of go through this again. I will turn to ask if there are any questions, because we may have covered some of the information earlier if you just came in late. So questions to Shalom.
So one question that I want to address was in terms of the application, if you've already taken a few advanced level courses, that hoping that credit will be accepted. What are your requirements? What are the...
Okay, so if you have taken courses as a non-degree seeking student, maybe you wanted to just get your feet wet or something in graduate education. So that goes back to the requirements of the graduate school, the overall graduate school, which stipulates that all coursework culminating in a degree needs to be completed within a 6-year time frame. So if you took a course this past year, or maybe 2 years ago, and you're going to graduate with your MSN, which will be in the summer of 3 years from 14, in the summer of 17, you just have to do the math to see when you took that course, and if it falls within 6 years of the end of July of 2017, if I'm adding that up right, then it will likely be able to transfer in, if, of course, if would replace a course that we offer. If it's something totally, totally different, it might not count for something. So it needs to be within that 6-year time frame to when you would graduate. If it was 10 years ago, information has changed and you're just going to need to retake the course. So if it is in that 6-year time frame.
And it goes towards the graduate, not necessarily the next FLT program, is that what I'm understanding? For example,
the graduate college is the one who makes that rule.
Okay.
So we can't change it. We know it on your transcript, and so once you would get admitted to the program, then you would contact me and just say, can I transfer in this nursing theory course that I took, so that then we can figure out your plan of study, and maybe you wouldn't need to take that nursing theory course in fall. Okay.
Is there a maximum of credits that will transfer in?
Yes, there is, and it depends on where they're transferring in from. We accept, I think, up to 16 credits from Minsku schools and up to 10 credits from other schools.
What is your rate of graduation? The percent that graduate?
Do you know anybody who hasn't graduated in the last 5 years?
Yeah, there was a student who life happened. It just got really complicated, and so she, I think, a year and a half through the program said, I have to take care of everything else. But
yeah, I don't know that we've had anybody fail out kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So, it's extremely high. I don't even know if we have a percent for it because it's so rare. That somebody doesn't go through to completion.
Because most of the time it's issues, family issues.
Yeah,
that's the one I know.
Yeah.
So, not even most, it's the one time.
Yeah, and I know somebody's coming back in this semester to from our old curriculum, so she needs to finish her thesis because stuff happened, and so she took like a year and a half off because she's coming back to finish, so, which I was surprised to hear. I thought life had happened and that was going to be it, so I'm very happy.
The on-site classes, did you cover that already? But they're on one day?
We try to have it be on one day, but if it's going to be a nine-hour day, that might be where we choose to put a class one afternoon and then another one the next morning. They're here.
The only time that's not true is your second spring semester is when health assessments is offered. And faculty, it used to be offered every single week, and just because it is a hands-on course, if you're going to succeed in clinicals, you need lots of practice. So it used to be once a week. This semester, we're trying to make it like nine times out of the semester, so that a little bit of the work at least can be done outside. But the students have been very receptive because they get it, and then after the fact, very positive about everything that they learn in that. So that second spring, it's nearly weekly meetings. And it's usually Thursday or Friday, and you'll know at least a semester ahead when they're going to be offered. In the summertime, because we all love our weekends in Minnesota, in the summertime, historically we've been doing them either Tuesdays or Thursdays, so you'll have plenty of time to adjust schedules.
How many times? So 9 times in that one semester, otherwise what is the average amount of time?
Four.
Okay.
And what's on weekend?
No, they're either Tuesdays or Thursdays for the most part, but then depending on faculty availability, sometimes that has been a Friday. But it's not weekends.
And the other thing, the essay, it doesn't take 45 minutes, 30 minutes, so whenever you are finished, in there, we kind of allow an expanded time because hooking up. So everybody, the username and the password, like the guest username and guest password, are written on the board in the other room that we're going into. So that would be the username, the guest username and password. It's all the same for everybody. So just look to the board there, if we have problems signing on, just let us know. That's kind of why we build in a little extra time for the essay, but it really shouldn't take that long to complete this. And then email it to me, raise your hand when you're done, and then we'll get you the jump drive, and you can save it onto the jump drive. And then return here for if you want to hear anything or have more questions. I'll start again at noon here. And otherwise, you're free to go.
Let's plan on actually starting at like 20 after, so that you don't feel like you have to like run. So
yeah.
Take care of whatever
you
need to
hit the
take
bathroom.
Care.
And